Hello and welcome to Daily Mirror Online. This is On Fire. I'm Iswaran Ratnam. Our guest today is the Minister of Media and the Cabinet Spokesperson, Kehilia Rambukwela. Minister Rambukwela, welcome to the show. Let me start off by asking you about the composition of this new government that has just been appointed. There's a lot being said about some of the ministers, some of the state ministers. Do you think that this government will meet the expectations of the government, of the people?
Well, that's the intention, right? Based on that intention, you have mapped up this structure. As we move through, we might experience some requirement for maybe changes, or we will stick to it. The authorities may have done a very comprehensive study of exactly what the promises and how you relate the promises to reality. And for that, the requirement of the structure of ministries and ministers. So I'm confident that there are certain areas where some people might feel why, and it's sort of with a question mark. But I can explain to you if you come out with any of those areas.
So let me ask you. I mean, one of the concerns that were raised were about, I'll not mention names, but let's say, like, you know, there were ministers in the current cabinet who, during the last parliament, behaved in a very, you know, unprofessional manner in parliament. And then you have certain portfolios that have been given, which some are questioning as to why. Let's, for example, say a minister for BATIC.
Yeah, good that you came out with it. You see, in mid-70s and late 70s and early 80s, before the 83 riots, the tourism was one of the main incomes of the country, and it was really, really flourishing, you know. And one of the main items are the BATICs. If you look at from Colombo to Maravilla, from Colombo to Kandy, Colombo down south, you know, people used to break just the front of houses and do a showroom. Yeah, that was so lucrative, and then there was a huge market for that. And I know some people who bought houses in Colombo 7, you know, was involved in BATIC trade. So it's a huge, huge food, clothing, housing are things that you need to embark on. Those are areas you'll never fail. Now, if I may cite the cite another country who is like Indonesia, 3% of the GDP is from the BATIC sales, right? Of course, the BATIC is cheaper because they are more mechanized rather than manual. I think where we went wrong was after the 83 riots, we had a very low turnover in terms of tourism. And people used to bring this printed BATIC from Indonesia and various countries. So it had a natural death together with the 83 riots, and then with fewer tourists coming to Sri Lanka, bringing in imported batiks, right? So, say in Indonesia, the Friday is known as a casual day, like the private sector. And they are given a message to have the batiks, so they wear batiks. If you make that system here, you are talking of 1.5 million batiks immediately on the spot. And then also there is still the market in the world market, and we should pursue. And then we did an excellent job. Our BATICs are well known, right? I mean, still you have some of the people like Rick Buddy and them surviving because of their export orders. When the tourism in fact went up to say almost 2 million from about 400,000 then, I'm sure that's a very lucrative market. And then I think there are certain lost areas, say the clay. Right, I will add that, right, batiks, clay, various. Now say for instance, beetle. I saw a sort of consignment going to Pakistan. When the cricketers come, they have a complete bundle of it, you know. Right, so there's a huge market. We're areas where we have totally neglected, and we have taken them as, this beetle, ericanut, you know, something. But those are things that you don't plant, in fact, in Sri Lanka. It just grows, right? So all you need is a proper management and bring modern technology into it. Now, one might fail to bring modern technology to Beetle, thinking that Beetle, what a Beetle. But that value has to be given. And then the value addition has to be incorporated. Say, for instance, you take pepper, black pepper. Okay, there's a demand. But there's a huge demand for pepper oil in the US, which you can do easily, right? Then, apart from that, you have other sort of non-traditional exports, which are totally neglected. I'll tell you a good example. Dumbara Mitiyavatha, when I was the provincial minister, Dumbara Mitiyavatha, the industrial, the clothing was, we were unable to meet the demand from Germany directly, right? We were completely, I mean, we were able to give only about 15% of the requirement. We were trying to improve it. But later on, I think this Barbara Sansone went and got that market. You are selling a sarong at 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 rupees. That's a local market and an international market, right? So these are things that are neglected. I'll tell you another thing. One might say the Hampa seller, right? The Hampa seller. Then the preschool. Yeah, the preschool. You and I have been to preschool, and that's where we are today, is the basis of the preschool. So preschool must be given that place of pride. And when you look at the education ministry, it is incorporated into that. Unfortunately, that becomes the last in the agenda of education, because so many things, so many other things, teachers transfers, you have 300,000 teachers around, you have 4.2 million children, you have 10,000 schools to manage. So when you have the minister concerned in terms of as a minister and even a state minister, you tend to neglect. It's not that you do it deliberately. It is just that the workload is too much that you cannot handle. But when you focus things like the preschool, right, your deficiency is shown, and then his responsibility would be to attend to it, at least for the first year or two, till you put them in place. You need that system. When you look at, one might be, you know, sort of take it as, you know, as anybody else, right? Unless you go into it in detail and see what the purpose, the intention, as I explained to you.
And what about the faces behind these ministries? I mean, the concern is that, you know, some of these ministers and state ministers might behave like they did during the political crisis.
Well, I may not accept that situation, because I condone to it, but given the circumstances, I won't say that one can justify it, but things didn't happen spontaneously also, right? And that whole episode of events are not in isolation. I can also bring certain things which certain criticisms, they have a sort of helpless situations by using the power, abusing power by even the speaker at that time, right? So there were no redress for any of them. So these are natural reactions which I don't justify. I hope that entire episode, not one of it, you know, you can't take, you know, bits and pieces of it. The entirety of it will never take place in this year, in the future. That's my hope, and, you know, I mean, I pray for it, yeah.
And what is the vision of this government over the next 5 years?
Well, I think A is that we are an agriculture-based country. We need to look at that sector and give priority to that area. Number two is that the industrialization should be based on agri-based industries, priority. Number three is foreign direct investment. And to supplement that, I think we have to make use of the port city. That's a money spinner if you use it well, if you really use it well, you know. So I think those are areas. And also, of course, on the other side, I mean, this is the economic part of it, I say. Other side is the decency and the kind of discipline citizen, and then drug-free country, underworld to deal with the underworld. You say the sanity must prevail and the country must be based on that. You know, this is a country, dharma country, you know, based on that. So I believe that is one area, another area where we are looking at seriously, right? I mean, you are able to walk across the country freely without any hassle. Today, that's not the case. So you need to make this country livable for everybody and lovable for everybody, you know, I mean, to sort of be happy to be Sri Lankan, right? There are a few things to do that. You need, one is safety, security, discipline, to live without any hassle and being pressurized by any unwanted antisocial groups, right? So these are things, the drug menace, underworld has to be controlled at whatever the cost.
So your government will give an assurance to the people that we will not see another Easter Sunday attack?
Well, we have proved that. 30 years of agony, we were able to get rid of it. And ever since we got rid of Prabhakaran on the 2009 May 19th, there were not one incident in the country. Not one single, nowhere in the world. Nowhere in the world, because we have dealt with terrorists. You can come to settlement by way of settlement or by militarily. There have been isolated incidents. But in Sri Lanka, up to the incident of this Easter Sunday, we have never had anything related to terrorism. Right? So we are quite sure, and sometimes we are very confident that we can maintain that situation.
And some would not just ask, but some were actually asking as well about how you would deal with these individuals from the former government who neglected their duties resulting in the Easter attacks. How would your government deal with
that? I suppose the law should prevail, and one country, one law. Right? Simple answer.
And the coronavirus situation is something that has really affected not just businesses, but the ordinary people in this country as well. Do you see a turnaround anytime soon?
Well, I think you need to have a note of appreciation for all the people involved in that. Health sector particularly, of course, the president's directives, health sector, the defense forces, you know, it's a combined effort. It's amazing, touch wood, right? I mean, you had, 11 or 12 deaths. Then apart from that, we have nearly 2,900 or something, 2,800 recovers, right? It's amazing, you know. Look at the next. So somebody was saying that this is because of the heat and there's, you know, equators and, you know, all kinds of, I think, very unreasonable proposals and suggestions. But at the end of the day, we have controlled that extremely well, I would say, thanks to all sectors involved in that area. Having said that, the drawback that we are experiencing as a consequence to this is terrible in my terms. It's not easy. We are on an uphill task, be very honest. 2005, when President Mahinda Rajapaksa was in office, again it was like the tsunami. But tsunami, we had enough and more countries where they were willing to extend assistance to us. Here, the whole world, if you look at America, 45 million people out of jobs. 8 trillion was released from the reserves to the public to keep the currency floating, right? So it's not easy. One thing that we are focusing is the self-sufficiency within, you know, with regard to food items and things like that. Then, of course, service sector, I don't know how we are going to manage. We have to manage the service sector. Then then tourism, then foreign employment, we have major incomes, are definitely affected. So we need to look at extravagances will have to be curtailed. We have to simplify our lives. And also have confidence in ourselves dealing with this. It's a tough job, but I think the confidence and discipline self-discipline, finance discipline can bring about a change, I believe.
And successive governments, I mean, when Mahinda Rajapaksha was president and then the former president, during their campaigns and when they were elected to office, they consistently spoke about issues in the north and east and addressing that issue. We're not really seeing that so much so from this president and this government. Is that something that is now taking a back seat?
I have a different view. My contribution to that is I think there are only very few people who are talking about the political solutions. It is more economic. And I can see this time, mind you, 11 people were elected in Northeast to SLPP, the alliance of the SLPP, giving a clear indication. Be very honest, I've lived couple of weeks soon after my graduation. My best friend, I got married, and I was the best man. Robin Jebusiela, right? I went over there. I went for 4 days. Ended up almost staying there 1 month. We had to buy clothes also because everybody was so close to us. I mean, one thing they always considered as we are the elder brothers, and you know that kind of respect and the mutual. It was amazing. I'm one of the people who really cry as to what happened. You know, that relationship was never on political base, right? They all wanted their irrigation. They all wanted a buyback guarantee for their products. They all wanted a good education system. They all wanted a just between the communities, right? And that was broken down from various places at various times. I'm sure that all politicians are equally responsible for this, including, moreover, like the speech made by my good friend Gajendra, right, former chief minister. I mean, you're talking of harmony, but that's completely based on total disharmony, right? I would say that the Gramaraj of India, that is something that has to be looked at seriously. Give more money to these areas. Give more money to these Pradesh Sabhas or Grama Raj or whatever you call it. Get them to have their water supply. Get their fertilizer on time. Get their products marketed somewhere, right? And give them guarantees. Give them assurances. The insurance schemes for the farmers. Have a better university or improve the university. Have more faculties. You see, we had the Yal Devi, which is, yeah, you know, after 27 years. Get this transport system moving, you know. I'm sure that people are willing to live in brotherhood in what we experienced along here. So this political interest is like few people. Like, I think some of the people who are the so-called the diaspora, who is never interested in coming back here, yeah, making, I think they're on the collecting spree. Right, on the basis that we will get you a separate state, they sort of brainwash them to such an extent. Right, you see that there's a sharp change in the northern people and the eastern people. Right, now say TNA represented them as the only representative of the Tamil. Then we have been arguing, we've been talking about it during the event. Right, now I don't think they have any right to say call it the only representative of the Tamil people. Right.
But then when you have people like Vigneshwaran and Gajan Ponnambalam coming into parliament, mm-hmm, who have also come in not on the same line but something even more strong, if I may say so.
No,
I
mean, yes. What happens is you have 10% or 15% of extremists under this situation. And then extremists are created by some of the interested parties. Mm-hmm. Right? They make them to feel to be extremists. Average Tamil person in the north, unfortunately, I can't go and spend time, right? My age will be revealed then. I graduated in 76, and 76, and Mr. Devanayagam came to attest the wedding. I still remember. He gave a gold coin, and that's a tradition there, right? So, and those parents, I think they didn't want us to leave. Nimalan, who had the hotel there, only 50-room hotel, he was also a batchmate of mine. Right. So we, I saw that harmony, I saw that brotherhood, I saw that kind of so knitted, right, like people to people, right? Somewhere down the line we had gone wrong somewhere, right? I think this first thing, I think firstly the single only thing, perhaps, right? Then the standardization for whatever the reason, right? You know, there's a few things that hurt them, and that gave enough and more ammos for these total extreme groups to sort of build on, right? Unfortunately, we have the majority single have given certain material for them to think so. Those limited guys who are interested in political power capitalized out of it to the maximum, and I think it's so sad that it happened that way. I'm sure that, you know, without antagonizing, without being arrogant, that those are two things that I think that hurts people. If you can honestly convince, now see that Major, somebody who was there, Ratnapriya, somebody, they, how people, you know, hung on to, you know, old ladies, you know, were crying there. So that's the atmosphere I would like to see before, you know.
So do you see the government working maybe with someone like Vigneshwaran and Gajan Ponnambalam, trying to convince them about your stance?
You see, their attitude that was expressed at the very outset doesn't speak that in that tone, in that tenor, right? Hopefully they'll understand that they will not want to have another calamity of the, you'll see.
And are y'all ruling out the full implementation of the 13th Amendment and devolution of powers?
No, the 13th Amendment has been issue for how many? So don't you think you need to have revisit the whole thing? Because from 1986 we have been talking about the police powers and the land powers. And then I personally feel, I've been a minister, leader of the opposition at the provincial council, you can put a different system to better use to harness and to sort of bring about more decency, harmony.
So you will even tell India, no, this is not the solution?
I don't think India, my humble opinion is India was also not there. They just want to get rid of a issue at that point of time. That's my thinking, right? So, and then this concurrent list. Right, you have a government list, this concurrent list, you know, I mean, and then out of that, I'll give you 10,000 schools, 300 national schools, right? Then the people who are in the provincial schools are crying to become a national school because they feel there are more funding coming in, kind of thing. Now, the funding that was given to the north was not used by Vigneshwaran. Why? Just to keep people, make them feel more, give more hardship, and to get them sort of to be against the government or against the system.
And let's talk about your ministry. State media comes under you. Is state media, or has state media just played the role of being the mouthpiece of the government, or have they actually addressed or pushed issues faced by the public?
I really do not know whether this is mouthpiece or not. That is, I think that I have a different thinking. They should be the mouthpiece. There is no question about it. But mouthpiece, the interpretation of the mouthpiece is what matters. Say, if a government is progressing with is progressive, and then there is development taking place, I think it's the right to the right of the people and to know that. If the private sector is not doing that, then it is up to the government sector to show. So the government, the public will decide what to believe. All what I said, even at the outset, I said, let us be competitive. Say, for instance, they say X paper, don't read it, many bullshit or rubbish. But they say the Y paper, you know, maybe you have, that is the, so if the government paper can be said, that referred as, I say something useful is there, you know, government part of can be there. Because it's the only way that the government can sort of express themselves, no other system. So while doing that, you need to strike a balance, and for the people to have reading material, number one. You don't have reading material in many of the papers, right? First, I think. Number one is you must have some good reading material. You must be able to take something, absorb something, right? That's one. Number two is the political environment, the political requirement. of the existing government, government in office, has to also express their whatever the progressive activities. And while you are doing that progressive activities, you are giving right of publicity to that. If there are anything that is against the government, also should be part of it. So that the paper become competitive or the news become competitive. When the news become competitive, whether it is the government or the private sector, the people will accept what is competitive. That is what my idea. So this mouthpiece of government is part of it. Interpretation, I don't know.
Different. So what plans do you have as media minister for the Sri Lankan media overall?
I don't think you can bring in rules and control media, and that is not in the that should not be the system, and that should not be in the system also, right? It must be on consensus. You know, we need to talk. If you remember, when we had this media center, I had few members where they used to come and say, you know, they shouldn't have done that, they shouldn't have published that. Now that is very interesting, no? That's the stage that I'm looking at. That's the platform I'm looking at. You see, I should be able to tell you, "Hi, Cham, look here, that article is not right, I think." You should be able to have the courage, "Yes, I think it shouldn't have been there." You know, I mean, that is what you call a beautiful culture. It might be difficult, but I'm trying.
So you're guaranteeing media freedom as well?
I'm definitely guaranteeing media freedom.
And one of the most controversial issues that has been highlighted consistently is the murder of Lasantha Wickremathunga,
right.
The murder of Wasim Tajuddin.
Yeah.
The former government gave various assurances,
right,
on the investigations.
Yeah.
We're not really hearing that from your government.
You should ask from that government, because they are the people who accused that. They are the people who credited that to us, that we are responsible. And they had clear 5 years to investigate, right? So we denied that. Right from the beginning, we denied that our involvement. We denied the event had taken place, whatever the murders or the missing or whatever you call it. But we denied that we have no involvement. We wanted to investigate. We did whatever the investigation. Now, say in the whole world, there are so many murders that goes without final decision, without, you know, final findings. So I'm not saying that, I'm not bringing that example and trying to justify this, but now those are the areas where 2014 or the 15 government lived on. The change took place because of that. That's my view, right? One is corruption, other is this media, you know, harassment and all that. Now that was the assurance and guarantees given by the previous Jayapalani government for them to be elected. Those are the factors. Every time there's election, they bring Tajuddin, that poor, you know. Right.
So, since that is not a factor of this government, that is a matter of no concern as well?
No, I suppose the one country, one rule, justice will prevail. The systems that are placed for justice will have to carry on their investigations.
So would you all push for that investigation to continue?
I don't think we will push for anything, because it's not our duty to push it. It's a duty
Hands
of
off.
Them. No, it's a duty of the institutions to make sure. And the final results are right. If not, you know, we can question them. That's another part of it. We can't tell you do that, do this, and don't do that. Again, you become dictators.
Yeah.
Right? We don't do that. We say let these institutions be independent, let them carry out their investigations, and then let's come out with the results. And if it is not so, they will have to give a viable explanation as to why they can't find. They can say, okay, well, like, we can't find the witnesses, the proper witnesses, for whatever the reason that they, and it is not something that one has to be sort of, oh my God, this is, because it happened all over the world, unfortunately. But see, the people who accused us were given 5 years to do that. So obviously what the authorities on the other hand said, I believe what they said was that they are not sufficient evidence. Now that was proved over and over again, then in that case with the last 5 years of the Jayapalani government.
And then you were a member of the UNP at one time.
Yeah.
What is your take on the state of the UNP at the moment?
Well, I had the foresight to see what they were going to be after 20 years, right? So I made the change at the right time, thinking that, because I was the third highest preference person in All Island. One above me was Ranil Wickremesinghe, who was the party leader, and the other one was the Karu Jayasuriya, the deputy. That's on the numbers. If you're on the percentage wise, number one was Sajith, number two was Ranil, and I was number three. Either way, I was number three in All Island, right? So I certainly had a stake, but which I was not allowed to exercise.
So if there was a change back then, you probably would have stayed back with the UNP?
Sorry?
If there was a change in leadership?
I don't see it. I never saw that. And I don't see it either. You know, it's happening.
You don't see that happening even now?
No. I don't see it happening now even. Because what happens is now, now that you brought out this, because I'm very cautious about making remarks about individuals when they're not here. Now, I expected the present leader of the breakaway of the UNP to be more, I would say, pragmatic and more intelligent, but once he was given the saddle and the statements and the things that they make, I'm amazed, honestly. I mean, come on, you know, I mean, that's not what was expected, because when the people are behind scenes, sometimes your exposure is much less and you don't see. When the exposure is given only, you really see who and what.
Right, Mr. Ramakwela, thank you. Thank you for joining us on this show. And thank you. All the time we have for this.